Good afternoon, everyone. Thanks for joining us today for this webinar looking at the topic of cold spray repair. My name's Henry Begg. I manage our surface engineering section here at TWI. So I wanted to take the next probably about 40, 45 minutes or so to go over a little bit of information around our proposed project on cold spray repair. But before I get into that, get my slides to move. I just wanted to give a quick introduction, I suppose, for those of you who aren't necessarily familiar with TWI as an organisation. So we are an independent research and technology organisation based in the UK, set up over about 75 years ago to support industry with materials, engineering and joining applications. So we are a non-profit distributing company, limited by guarantee. We're owned entirely by our members. So we therefore offer independent advice and we try and bring together multidisciplinary teams to provide consultancy services or undertake advanced research to try and help solve our members' problems, whether that's at initial design stages, helping with material selection, production, quality assurance, all the way through to service performance and things like repair. So we're based out of our headquarters here in Cambridge, and this is where we undertake all of our cold spray activity. But we also have three other UK centres and another number of international offices as well. So as mentioned, we're here to support our members with their engineering challenges, and we seek to provide deep technical expertise in a range of different material science and joining applications. We interact across a range of different industry sectors, and we try to help members translate and implement technology and best practice, drawing on our kind of diverse experience and expertise. So that might be in process related developments. So perhaps bringing in new welding technologies forward. It might be in test methodologies, helping companies understand and certify new materials, joints, structures. It might be in the fundamental understanding of performance, and so that also includes things like failure analysis, and we also have quite a large activity on non-destructive testing. So we do around about £70 million of materials joining R&D every year, and we deliver this through a number of different types of project. A lot of it is dedicated one-on-one research for our member companies. We also get involved in government funded work. We also have what we call our core research program. So this is funded through our membership fees and benefits all of our different members. Or again, the topic of today, which is our joint industry projects, where we have a group of companies all interested in a similar problem who get together to sponsor some work. And my colleague Jarlene is going to talk a little bit at the end of this topic about how the sort of practicalities, I suppose, of how those types of projects are run. So we're about 800 people as TWI as an organisation, the majority of which are scientists, engineers, technicians, and we have something around 550 industrial members based all around the world, probably about 50% within the UK and 50% elsewhere. So hopefully that's given you a very brief overview of TWI as an organisation. I also wanted to just give people a quick introduction to the surface engineering team here at TWI. So we are a team of around about 20 scientists, engineers, technical staff, working primarily on member projects relating to coatings, but we also encompass corrosion and looking at interfaces through things like permeation technology. So in my team, we tend to focus on three main areas in terms of our in-house process capability. So that encompasses thermal spraying. So this is a range of different techniques, but they all generate a stream of molten or at least semi-molten droplets. And those are projected out of substrate where they solidify and then form a coating. We also get cold spray. So here, rather than create a stream of molten droplets, we create a stream of solid particles. So they're projected at high speed and deposit using kinetic energy. And I'll go into a little bit more detail about that later on. And we also look at electroplating. So this is currently a slightly smaller activity, and we're looking at some kind of unique capability around depositing materials from solution, but looking at using some interesting electrolytes that aren't necessarily based around water. So things like ionic liquids, deep eutectic solvents. So being able to put down coatings that you wouldn't be able to do otherwise. Now, it's important to note that we also have a number of other teams here at TWI that work on technologies that would classically be called surface engineering. And we work very closely, but they're managed under different teams. So we also have quite a large activity looking at laser cladding. So that includes recent variants such as ELA, extreme high-speed laser application. We also have teams looking at things like laser surface modification, so ablating small amounts of material off the surface of all kinds of materials to create different patterns and textures to be able to introduce new types of functionality into the surface. And then we also have an activity looking at sort of wet film coatings. So this is things like paints, conversion coatings, sol gels, things like that as well. So we have quite an extensive suite of equipment available in-house at TWI to be able to support our members with their research. So this includes somewhere in the order of about 10 different thermal spray systems, including our latest edition of high-velocity air fuel systems. So we're looking at independently assessing the potential cost and performance benefits that this type of technology can bring. We also have a number of different cold spray systems available, both high pressure and low pressure systems, and they're capable of running with both nitrogen, helium, and compressed air. And then finally, we also have a range of surface preparation equipment as well. So this is often a slightly overlooked process, and something like grit blasting doesn't necessarily have quite the same technological appeal to some people. But nevertheless, it's a hugely important process, and pretty much all coating failures can be traced back to not necessarily doing the surface preparation correctly. So we therefore have a mechanized grit blasting cell, so we're able to look at controlling that process and understanding that process in a greater level of detail. We also have some other surface preparation equipment as well. So related to some of our laser surfacing activity, we also look at pulsed laser ablation for cleaning of surfaces. And we also look at things like atmospheric plasma cleaning as well, particularly for adhesive bonding type applications as well. So we also support our members across a range of different technology readiness levels, and we have different facilities available for supporting that. So we have two of our original smaller spray booths, and we tend to use these for slightly more fundamental coupon level studies to be able to understand materials, processes, optimize deposition. However, we also recently invested in upgrading our large-scale coating facility, so we can also work on multi-meter scale components and actually understand some of the challenges that can be faced in scaling up coating deposition to real parts or sub-assemblies. So this facility has two synchromotion link robots on a track. We can accommodate some quite large parts, so I think the longest dimension is probably around 6 meters. We have kind of forklift access into the booth, so we can look at doing prototype coating component demonstrations. It's also worth noting that this facility is also laser safe as well, so we do also look at hybrid processes as well, so that we can perform multiple different operations within the same booth and using the same robots and equipment. And then finally, we've just finished the installation of our dedicated cold spray additive manufacturing cell provided by Titomic. So this cell is specifically configured for additive manufacturing operations using spray deposition. And it allows a much more flexible control of things like tool paths. It also has a large liquid nitrogen fed gas supply, So this means we can spray for really extended periods of time within a single spray run and don't have to worry about changing over gas bottles, gas banks, things like that. And that also obviously significantly reduces the cost of running some of these systems. And we do get involved in lots of process comparisons, not just on the technical side, but also helping our members understand perhaps those trade-offs that can be there in terms of cost and quality. So putting together different cost models of what process is right for what application. So in addition to our spray facilities, we also have a number of support functions. So this includes things like process monitoring. So including the high watch particle diagnostic system shown here. But we also have things like offline programming, simulation. So we don't necessarily have to do everything physically. We can perhaps reduce the amount of development needed by taking some of the development and doing it in a simulation environment rather than a real world application. So TWA also have a pretty extensive range of materials characterization and testing facilities. And a lot of that is specifically designed around the measurement of surfaces. So we have equipment like non-contact profilometry, so we can understand the roughness and the topology of surfaces, and things like wetting capability, so measuring surface contact angles, understanding surface energy, as well as the extensive suite of materials characterization facilities, so with scanning electron microscopy, EBSD, XRD, that kind of thing. So hopefully that gives a kind of very brief introduction, I suppose, to some of the background, some of the capability available at TWI, available to our members. Before I get into the specific project idea as well being proposed, I did also want to take a few minutes just to introduce cold spray as a technology, just in case there are people out there in the audience who perhaps aren't as familiar with this as a technology and wanted to understand a little bit more about what it is, how it works, that kind of thing. So cold spray is a solid state deposition process. It uses a high velocity gas jet of some suitable process gas to accelerate powder particles up to supersonic velocity, and it projects them at a substrate. So on impact above some critical velocity, which depends on both the material being deposited, but also the substrate you're depositing onto, the particles will in fact bond to either the substrate or previously deposited particles. And so the repeated impact of these particles results in the buildup of a deposit. So to create that high velocity gas jet, we typically heat high pressure inert gas in some kind of chamber and allow it to pass through a converging diverging nozzle. So that gas expands adiabatically, it cools, it starts moving very fast. So you go from hot, slow moving high pressure gas to cool, low pressure, very fast moving gas. So into that gas stream, we then inject powder particles, and that then accelerates them within the gas stream to very high velocity. So often we use nitrogen as the gas of choice, but for any given set of parameters, helium will give you much faster gas velocities and therefore usually gets you better deposition. It is obviously a lot more expensive though. So having the right trade-off in conditions versus quality is really critical to what's trying to be achieved. It is also worth noting as well that under certain circumstances, we can also use compressed air. So that may be appropriate for certain applications, but it will have an impact on the quality of the material being deposited. So when a powder particle impacts, it undergoes this very rapid and very localized deformation. At that interface between the particle and the substrate, you get oxide layers being broken. You get this very localized plastic flow, and that creates this intimate metal on metal contact. And that results in a solid state. Pro scale, it's happening at a micro scale. typically powder particles tend to be in the range of somewhere between 10 and 50 microns. And so you that repeated impact of those powder particles then builds up your deposit. So unlike thermal spray techniques, where adhesion is primarily mechanical, with particles gripping onto asperities on the surface, as they cool, cold spray forms a true metallurgical bond, which can result in some very high adhesion strengths. However, as the particles go quite a lot of deformation during the process, we can introduce significant amounts of cold work, and that can lead to the material having some limited ductility. This obviously, of course, depends a little bit on the amount of recovery that goes on during the process or after the process, or indeed if the heat level is high enough, it can actually lead to recrystallization that does offset some of that change in ductility between cold spray deposit and parent material. So people often try and compare cold spray to other deposition processes available, and it's often helpful to try and map that against different axes. So one that's often used and can be helpful to get an idea of how the different processes compare is to look at substrate temperature and coating thickness. And cold spray occupies this quite unique space down here where actually the substrate temperature can be kept fairly low. But also, as you know, you can spray very high thicknesses as well. So this lends the process to having some kind of unique advantages that mean it has certain applications, and particularly in repair that we'll talk about slightly later on. So yeah, if we compare it to certain other processes, you know, classically, if you were doing some type of weld overlay, and I'd include something like laser cladding within that category, you would get a true metallurgical bond. You'd get a weld between your deposit and your substrate material. But that means your materials have to be metallurgically compatible. So you don't necessarily want them to react. You don't want to form intermetallic species at that joining layer. You also might need to worry about dilution effects. It does mean you don't necessarily get any oxide within your deposit. So with a weld, you will get, generally, if it's done well, a very high density, a very oxygen-free, dense layer of material being deposited. You can also build up quite thick layers. It is difficult perhaps to put down too thin a layer, although that is changing with some of the new laser techniques coming online, particularly with something like ELA. You can deposit very, very thin layers successfully using a laser cladding type operation. Now, cold spray is, as I say, mostly a metallurgical bond. There can be some element of mechanical bonding as well, depending on the process. We can deposit generally metals and alloys. It's very difficult to deposit ceramics. You can deposit some cermets and metal matrix composites. The nice bit is you don't necessarily get much oxidation during flight, and you can build up some really thick layers as well. So we've sprayed things in the past well in excess of 10 millimeters. So you can spray some really quite thick layers. And if we compare that to thermal spray, as I said, that's primarily a mechanical bond. So your adhesion strength is generally lower. Thermal spray does have some advantages though. So you do probably have access to a wider range of materials that you can deposit. So particularly if you want to put down ceramic layers, you're probably needing to look at thermal spraying where you can actually melt those ceramics and put them down. However, if you're trying to build back metallic layers, because the particles are molten during flight, you do tend to get some oxidation. You do tend to get more porosity, more defects, more oxide within that structure. And so your mechanical integrity of the coating does tend to be less. Thermal spray, because you're depositing from liquid droplets as well, you do tend to get limitations on how thick you can spray. So particularly with residual stress buildup, you're generally limited to around about putting down 1 millimeter as your maximum thickness. So TWI, I've been working in cold spray technology for probably about the past 15 years now. So we have quite a lot of experience in putting down a whole range of different materials. And we've looked at quite a wide variety of different materials for this technology. So from perhaps some of the slightly easier to put down aluminium and titanium alloys, including kind of aerospace grades, so 2000 series, 7000 series aluminiums, both grade 2 and grade 5 titanium alloys, as well as some slightly more exotic beta forming titanium. We've also looked at slightly more high temperature alloys, so perhaps some of the nickel super alloys like 65, 718. We've also looked at things like copper, copper bronzes. Steels can be slightly more problematic, but it is possible, certainly. And certainly we've done quite a lot of work putting down different compositions of stainless steel. So 316 we've looked at quite extensively. And cold spray is often looked at for perhaps some of the slightly more exotic materials out there. So with various degrees of success, you can put down different refractory metals, so things like tantalum, niobium, materials like this. And these examples just give you an idea of what the cross-section of some well-deposited cold spray coatings look like. So at the top, we've got a titanium 6-4 put down in its as-deposited state, and then following heat treatment, where we've recrystallized and changed this microstructure. So in terms of applications, cold spray can be used for coatings. We can put down nice high integrity coatings for things like anti-corrosion, for wear resistance, for looking at electrification, putting down very conductive coatings of things like copper. It's been used extensively in particularly within the defense sector for repair applications. It's particularly well suited for materials where it's very challenging to put materials down via melt-based route. So this might be something that oxidizes easily, that cracks, that where the substrate's in a particular condition that you don't necessarily want to influence too much. And then finally, increasingly cold spray has been looking at for additive manufacturing applications. So actually you can do very high build rates with this process. So it's certainly comparable with wire arc in terms of deposition rates. And it's also very scalable. Again, you're not necessarily limited by needing a powder bed. It's much more like a DED process. So your scalability really is just determined by the size of the robot and gantry system that you're looking with. So if we look into cold spray repair in a little bit more detail, this has been one of the main commercial uses of cold spray to date. It's really been spearheaded over the past 10 years or so by the US Department of Defense. The Army Research Lab in particular have done a lot of research into this. And actually there are multiple approvals already approved for in-service platforms on military aircraft and a number of naval assets as well. There's also been quite a lot of efforts in recent times to translate some of that technology into the civil sector as well. So I guess why is cold spray advantageous for certain types of repair? So I think, as I mentioned, that the oxygen, if you've got a material that is particularly sensitive to being oxidized, so particularly the light metals often used in lots of lightweighting aerospace type applications, so aluminium, titanium, we can spray these materials because everything remains within the solid state. We don't have to worry about oxygen pickup during deposition, and we can do it just in normal everyday atmospheric conditions. We don't have to worry too much about any kind of inert shielding gas, anything like that. Because it's solid state, there's also no phase change during the deposition. So if you've got a material that is challenging to deposit via a melt-based route, so it might undergo segregation, cracking. It might, you know, do something very weird with the microstructure where you get odd epitaxial anisotropic growth of materials. Again, because we're doing everything in solid state with cold spray, we don't necessarily have to worry about that. Because there's no phase change as well, you've got no liquid going to solid at any point, you don't necessarily have the same contraction that occurs. And so often the residual stress generated can be less than melt-based processes. And with a lot of cold spray conditions, what you end up doing is actually introducing a compressive residual stress. So for repair applications, that can actually be hugely beneficial from extending a fatigue life. So, you know, often things are shot peened to help introduce a slight amount of residual compressive stress into a surface to reduce the fatigue crack initiation. Cold spray has a similar type of process that occurs. So this means that for repair applications, we can actually return lots of components into service that would otherwise be scrapped. So this represents quite a big cost saving potentially. It also means that we can do in situ repair. So we don't necessarily need to take the part off the platform to repair it. Cold spray, there are a number of different variants available. Many of those are portable in some way, or at least mobile, and so can be taken to the platform and actually repairs done in situ. And again, compared to other types of process, again, there's the possibility that, we don't necessarily have a detrimental effect on the lifetime of the component. So another aspect of cold spray is that we get very low heat inputs. So while the hot side of the process gas can be very hot, so for spraying titanium, the hot part of the gas can be at 1100 degrees C. By the time that gas is expanded and the amount of heat input going into your part, you can maintain very low substrate temperatures. So this is important if you've got a sensitive material that you're trying to repair. So perhaps you've got a precipitation hardened aluminium alloy that you really don't want to change the temper condition of that substrate when you're trying to repair it. So cold spray is perfect for that kind of thing. Again, compared to a more typical fusion welding process, you also don't create any kind of heat affected zone. So there's no region within that repair within the substrate of that repair where you've changed the microstructure in any way. So you don't necessarily introduce regions with inferior mechanical properties. And so that means, again, that the mechanical integrity of your part, not necessarily your repair, but the unrepaired part can be entirely maintained. It does also mean that you get multiple attempts at repair. So if for whatever reason something doesn't quite go to plan during your repair, if you've had to come up with a very controlled welding process where you're really managing the heat input very carefully and something goes wrong, you don't necessarily have the option to start again. Whereas with cold spray, because you're not really affecting the substrate material properties in any way, if for whatever reason you get some sort of blockage or something goes wrong with your repair, there's absolutely no reason why you can't grind that out and start again. And I slightly mentioned this earlier, but again, there's lots of different process variants available. So we can run things with high pressure systems that use lots of gas, so perhaps a little bit more controlled. We can run things with low pressure systems that are perhaps a little bit cheaper and can be more manual. We've got different options available to us in terms of what process gas we use. So we can use nitrogen, we can use helium, we can use air. And we can run things robotically and control things very carefully within a more structured workshop environment. Or we can take things to site, do slightly more one-off repairs and do manual deposition. And this means there's quite a large space available to us in terms of cost and quality. So cold spray is quite flexible in terms of what types of application can be considered. And it means we've got multiple different options available at different price points. And then finally, we tend to get really high quality deposits compared to some other techniques available. So for instance, compared to some thermal spray techniques, we'll probably get much higher adhesion strengths. We often get much higher densities, less oxide. We can also deliberately repair with a different composition. So we can introduce something if you've had a part that has worn and needs a dimension built back up. We can actually put something down that is more wear resistant. Or conversely, if something's corroded and you're looking to repair that corrosion damage, we can actually put something back, perhaps back in that's more corrosion resistant. So that means there's the opportunity for a longer repair lifetimes, or even to actually remanufacture the parts and not just return it to service, but return it to service and increase the performance. Now, cold spray is not perfect, or else it would be widely available everywhere. There are some limitations to the process. So deposit performance is one of those. So while we do tend to get good densities, good adhesions, moving towards actually taking structural credit for that repair, rather than just doing a dimensional repair, there are still some challenges. In terms of the mechanical performance of those repairs, and ductility being one of those. So as I said, a lot of cold work goes into it. So actually often you do end up with quite limited ductilities and things do or can fail in a slightly more brittle manner than people would like. There's also a bit of a lack of performance data. Like while this technique has been around for many years now, actually it's not as well adopted by the industry. There is not that necessarily that performance history that companies can call on. Actually understanding performance as a function of different spray parameters for the various different spray systems that exist can still be a challenge in being able to qualify and certify repairs. And in particular, the sort of tensile fatigue and fracture data is a little bit more of a gap perhaps in some of the literature. And then finally, we see one of the other limitations or barriers to people using this is that actually because it is a relatively new technology, the standards and codes available, that landscape of being able to draw on that documentation is a little bit more difficult. There perhaps aren't the guidelines, best practice documents, documentation that companies can take and actually understand how to implement it within their particular industry. Repair geometry, material system, or type of repair that they're trying to achieve. So this is really the main thrust of what we're proposing here as our joint industry project. So we're trying to launch this project to address some of those limitations, and we're aiming to do quite a broad project that aims at different levels to cover lots of different bases. So broadly speaking, we're splitting these down into three main work packages. So one, looking at slightly more fundamental, lower technology readiness level developments to try and improve that process to actually get cold spray deposits performing slightly better, to get that mechanical integrity better by optimizing the process itself, come up with innovations. We're also then doing a work package on actually just generating performance data. They're actually trying to fill some of those gaps, giving TWI members that confidence in the process, in materials. So being able to then draw on for their own specific needs to help support future qualification and certification efforts that they can draw on and look up those fatigue data perhaps. To understand whether what they're trying to achieve is doable and is safe in the particular repair environment that they're looking at. And then finally, we're aiming to do a final work package at a slightly higher TRL level, really aimed at helping companies take this technology either in-house themselves or understanding it enough to be able to get the supply chain to sensibly do what they need them to. So really translating this technology into industrial practice rather than just understanding the science and the engineering of it. So if I go into these three topics in a little bit more depth. We're looking at some process developments. This outline joint industry project is very much at the stage where we're seeking input from potential sponsors to understand what their needs are and tailor the response of what we're trying to do here. But broadly speaking, we're aiming to look at powder modification. So TWI has done quite a bit of this in the past, looking at things like heat treating powders to actually manipulate the properties of the powder itself before it is deposited to try and improve both the deposition, but then also the subsequent performance of that deposit. We've also done quite a bit of work in the past on hybrid processes. So specifically laser assisted cold spray. So for particularly challenging materials, actually adding a small controllable amount of heat back into the process to try and aid both, well, to try and alter both the yield stress during that deposition event, but also perhaps then to add in a controlled level of heating, again, very locally, to try and influence that recovery and recrystallization that happens to, again, try and improve that mechanical integrity of the deposit. And then finally, also looking at some of the new tools available from kind of process monitoring side. So actually trying to tighten up those process windows, actually understand if it's possible to improve the deposit quality and simply through the improved reliability and repeatability over different geometries, over different spray conditions. So the second work package is then, understanding performance data. So this would be looking at, as I said, trying to understand the relationship between spray parameters and coating quality or deposit quality. Understanding, quantifying the differences between mechanized application and manual application. So perhaps there's some kind of knockdown factor that needs to be accounted for if you're doing an operation manually. Also understanding residual stress during deposition. So again, this is something we've looked at in the past and have had PhD students looking on, but actually understanding that evolution of residual stress during deposition will be able to help understand the ultimate performance of a particular repair geometry and how it's going to perform in service. And then finally, understanding the difference between mechanical performance across different coupon geometries. So people have looked at understanding particularly mechanical performance, so tensile, fatigue and fracture, but they tend to be working on a particular repair or particular coupon geometry, test coupon geometry, and understanding which type of geometry you use and what effect that has on the performance that you measure in the laboratory, and then how that then translates into a real world repair scenario is something that we're proposing in work package 2. And then finally, our final work package would be really designed around industrial practice. So creating document packs to support practical implementation of cold spray within an industrial environment. So right from the design of the repair, so creating frameworks to understand whether the proposed repair being considered is suitable for cold spray, has different requirements. So for instance, a dimensional repair on a non-safety critical part may need a very different repair qualification and certification from a load-bearing, fatigue-sensitive, safety-critical part. And so what frameworks can you put in place to actually understand how we go about doing that? We'd also be looking to put together some template instructions. Again, companies just so that they don't necessarily have to start from zero. They will almost certainly need to be tailored for specific company practices. But having some sort of starting point for people to take and adapt into their own procedures and processes, and including a lot of the specific requirements of cold spray. We'd also look to understand sort of quality assurance. So what types of witness coupons need to be sprayed if you're doing a repair? What non-destructive inspection techniques are available and applicable to cold spray? And then, yeah, also kind of best practice guidelines. So understanding perhaps some of the safety issues, some of the practical challenges in terms of what ancillary equipment do you need if you're doing cold spray repair, in terms of extraction, surface preparation, cleanliness, post-machining, that kind of thing. So that's it from me on the technical side of things. I now wanted to hand over to my colleague Alan, just to give people a bit more understanding of what a joint industry project at TWI looks like, and how it all works. So thank you very much, and I'll hand over to Alan at this point.
Thanks, Henry. Before I get into the presentation, I just want to remind everyone, if you have any questions, please feel free to use Q&A box, and me and Henry, we will try to answer the questions at the end of the presentation. So I will just use a few slides to explain actually how we launch joint industry project, how we launch and manage actually joint industry projects here at TWI. For those of you who hasn't or who haven't actually worked with us on JIPs, it is essentially a work program of mutual interest to a number of organizations, and each will contribute to fund the project. So typical JIP outputs include some issues relating safety and integrity, and it could be actually development of codes and standards as well. As Henry just mentioned, it will be part of the project delivery for the cold spray repair JIP. So it could be for the generic process development as well, depending on the work scope. The ticket price could vary from maybe 20K to 100K per year per sponsor per annum. The typical size of the joint industry project is between 3 and 10 sponsors. It is a project only available for TWI members, but at this stage, if you are interested to learn more, obviously you are welcome to attend the webinars and even later the launch meetings as well. Next slide, please, Henry. Right, there are many benefits of joining the TWI JIP. So first of all, it is definitely a shared benefits with reduced costs. Within the using the same amount of budget, you can fund many JIP topics, and that's the best way to leverage your R&D funds. So by actually attending or joining the cross-industry JIPs, it is a great way to increase your business visibility. Obviously, by resolving a shared industry problems, you can gain competitive advantage as well. Being able to fund the JIP means you are a TWI member. Obviously, there are more benefits than what I've been simply addressing here, the access to our world-class research capability. Next slide, please, Henry. Right, so there are mainly three stages when we launch JIP. The first stage is idea generation. We are, as a membership organization, we are in regular contact with our members. So whenever we have identified a common industry issue, we will propose a joint industry concept. Of course, as a member of yourself, if you're welcome to actually propose such ideas to us as well. So we're happy to initiate the process. So after the project, after the idea is initiated, we will be preparing a project launch. At the project launch meeting, we will confirm the final work scope or work details actually to be carried out in GIP. And after that launch meeting is held, we will issue a full proposal with obviously what has been agreed during the launch meeting, followed by the legal documents. And as soon as those contractual negotiation is all finished, then we'll be ready to kick off the project. Next slide, please, Henry. So just to explain a little bit about the next step and the timeline for this code 3 repair GIP. So we will be holding a launch meeting on the 27th of June. Please save the date. If you would like to attend the launch meeting, please feel free to get in touch. As I mentioned, the launch meeting is not limited to TWM members only. So even if you are not a TWM member, if you would like to attend the launch meeting, feel free to let us know. We will send you the invite. So after the launch meeting is held, as I mentioned, we will just basically issue the full proposal. The timeline we're looking to is to have the full proposal and participation agreements issued before end of the year, 2023. So we are planning a project start in January or Q1 2024. So I think this is the end of my presentation. I will hand the meeting back to Henry. Thank you.
Okay, thanks. So yeah, my contact details are on screen. Also, hopefully through the registration, you should have contact details of how to get in touch with us if you've got any follow-ups. I believe we do have a little bit of time, and I think there are some questions. Yes. So I'll try and go through these individually. So somebody asked on slide 13, 900 degrees C temperature, is it due to friction and deformation or due to the initial temperature of the particle carrier gas? So apologies, let me go back to slide 13. So you're referring to this image. So this is one particular simulation taken from the literature. That heating is primarily due to the deformation that's occurring. So that very localized shear instability that's forming at that interface causes heating of the particles. We also have one, so strain-based transformation still happening during cold spraying, e.g. cobalt. That's a really interesting question. It's certainly possible. I believe there have been instances in the literature of strain-based phase transformations happening. So forming deformation-induced martensitic transformations. I think it would depend, very strongly on the alloy system involved. But yes, it's certainly a possibility. Next one is, could you please explain the impact of using high versus low pressure on e.g. adhesion strength and material selection? In which case would you recommend helium instead of nitrogen? So high pressure versus low pressure is again an interesting one that I think people assume that high pressure means you use a high pressure gas, whereas low pressure use a low pressure gas, which isn't necessarily the case. That's the broad rule of thumb. But in reality, it's where the powder injection happens. So in high pressure cold spray, the powder is injected into that high pressure side of the converging diverging nozzle, whereas in low pressure, it tends to be injected in the low pressure side of that converging diverging nozzle. Now, that said, generally, when we're referring to high pressure cold spray, they are operating at higher temperatures, higher pressures. And that does mean you tend to get faster gas velocities. And in general, faster gas velocities gets you a higher quality deposit. That does mean that low pressure systems often tend to be a little bit more portable. They're usually a lower cost as well, both in terms of CapEx and OpEx. So it really depends on the type of repair you're going after. And I would say that for your comment as well around whether you should use helium or nitrogen. So certainly for repair applications, if you want the highest quality deposit, the most structure integrity of your deposit, helium would be the way to go. That said, helium has become increasingly expensive over the past 5 years, and almost everyone within the cold spray community is moving away from using helium, primarily from a cost point of view. There is also a environmental consideration as well, in that helium is a limited resource, and cold spray tends to be run as a full loss. So people don't tend to recover the gas. There are helium recovery systems available on the market, but they're very few and far between. So the next question is, have you down-selected particular processes or materials, or is that based on participants? How many different variants can you accommodate in the project, e.g. high-pressure titanium versus low-pressure aluminium? So again, a really good question. It's very much at the discretion of the sponsors, I think. So this is what we would aim to discuss during the JIP launch meeting. So we haven't down-selected anything at the moment. I would agree it can come across as a little bit vague, perhaps, but that is by design. Because we would like to get input from sponsors as to what their direction, and particularly on the alloy systems and materials of interest. We'd really like your feedback on one of the most. I think there probably is scope, depending on number of sponsors, to look at multiple systems. So please don't feel put off if your system's not immediately obvious at the outset. So the next question is cold spray an appropriate method for applying functionally graded coatings? So the short answer is yes. Again, going back to the fact that it's a solid state process, means that we have a little bit more control in a way, over what we put down. So at TWI we have systems that have multiple powder feeders that can operate independently. So yes, in theory, we can start fully with powder A, and then gradually increase that, increase powder composition B while decreasing powder composition A, and end up fully at the other composition. It may be a little bit, there may be some caveats to that, I suppose, in that if you're needing to spray a material that needs a very high gas temperature, so if you're spraying something that, like titanium for example, where we would typically spray at quite high gas temperatures, and wanted to functionally grade that with something that had a much lower melting point, so aluminium, you may need to compromise on this the temperature and the spray conditions of your titanium to be able to do that. So next question, is TWI a member of the AMS AM and repair subcommittees? So short answer is yes. We are involved. There is currently a standard being developed, I believe specifically cold spray additive manufacture, and we are a part of that, so yes. And we would probably try and interact with that subcommittee, particularly in the work package 3 activity, to make sure that we're harmonized with external standards bodies. Again, if there's any engagement from aviation authorities, so EASA or CAA or the MAA or the FAA, yes, we would look to engage on that and make sure that whatever guidance we were putting out was harmonized with that. So the next question, how does thermal stress vary between coating and substrate in this method? At the coating and substrate interface. So again, this probably depends very much on the material and the processing conditions involved. So there are, broadly speaking, two elements to residual stress formation. So there's a sort of peening stress that arises from the deformation, but there can also be a thermal stress as the particle cools and contracts, and it really depends very much on the material being sprayed and the process conditions being used to spray that. So the next question, after bonding, is it possible to perform heat treatment for stress relief so as to undo some of the work hardening of the substrate? Again, short answer is yes, absolutely. So to get the best properties out of your cold spray deposit, it's ideal to perform a heat treatment. However, if you are repairing something, often that's detrimental overall. That part of the advantage of cold spray as a process compared to a welding or a thermal spray operation or something is that you can put high quality material down without having to do some kind of post-weld heat treatment. And you know, if it was some sensitive alloy, you know, you may not want to overage your precipitation hardening, for example. But yes, certainly performing a heat treatment is beneficial. And that's why one of the process developments we would like to look at in work package one is doing very local transient heat treatments. So being able to heat treat your deposit, perhaps with a laser, but without actually affecting the underlying temper of the parent material. So the next question, is there a full appreciation of the work that has been done by the DoD/ARL on CMS repair? Will the project aim to validate these aspects that have already been done or focus on new unexplored aspects? The intention is to really focus on new aspects, probably within work package three, there will be an element of collating, summarizing, contextualizing previous work that has been done by others, and absolutely the Department of Defense Army Research Lab would be an area to draw on. You know, we're really not looking to reinvent the wheel here and charge you for it, that we are looking to do something novel here. Next question. So you mentioned that it would be potentially investigating in-process monitoring in work package one. Do you have any idea of what kind of process metrics this might be aimed at? So again, this is something that we would discuss with the sponsors at the launch meeting. I suspect the primary one that we might want to look at is probably some of the particle diagnostic measurements. So particularly being able to be agnostic to cold spray system. So there are a lot of, you know, manufacturers of cold spray equipment out there. We have a few different systems from different suppliers. But what we would like to do is actually understand what's happening at a process level and control at a process level much more carefully. And not necessarily just rely on the input parameters of the cold spray system. So actually understanding the particle speeds, temperatures, distributions, and then correlating that with deposit shape, deposit quality, whether that's adhesion strength, porosity. And again, exactly what those metrics you'd want to optimize for would be something we would try and develop in collaboration with the group of sponsors. So, and then I think the final question, what challenges did you face while spraying pure aluminium powder? Any issues with nozzle clogging, and which guns RTWR using? So yes, nozzle clogging can be an issue, particularly with lower melting point, softer alloys. So guns, typically we're doing most of our work with an Impact Innovations 511, if we're talking high pressure cold spray. We have had fewer nozzle clogging issues with low pressure systems. So we use what is now a Titomic D523, that's the old Dicomet system. One of the issues, again, around nozzle clogging does tend to be, in our experience, nozzle temperature. So trying to maintain a low nozzle temperature. So using appropriate water cooling on your nozzle. Nozzle material, I think we found, and nozzle condition can have a big effect on nozzle clogging. So again, we tend to use Cermet nozzles. So either silicon carbide or tungsten carbide bonded Cermets. And then also powder quality. So again, going back to the some of the topics around work package one, understanding and influencing powder, I think is key, not only in the deposition quality, but also in the process quality. So things like nozzle clogging, we found particularly with powder cuts that have large numbers and volume fractions below 5 microns, can result in poor performance on that front. Hopefully that's answered everyone's questions. I think there are no other open ones in the Q&A. So I think I'll put my contact details back up just at the end here. If anyone does have any follow-up questions, anything else they'd like to get in touch with us about surface engineering, cold spray, or indeed any other engineering challenges that you think TWI might be able to assist with, please don't hesitate to get in touch. Do drop me an email or pick up the phone. We've got one final question. last question was, what kind of action did you take to reduce nozzle clogging? And what is the solution? I would say mostly around the powder quality. There are other alternatives as well, perhaps depending on the type of the geometry of your powder injection, that can help as well, of influencing the gun setup. Talk further about this perhaps in detail. If again you want to send me a follow-up email, happy to have a follow-up phone call and discuss in further detail. Thank you very much for your attendance today, everyone. Enjoy the rest of the afternoon. I don't think there's anything else from Jalin or Becky on the practical front.
Yeah, that's fine.
On my side.
Great. All right. Well, thank you very much, everyone. Thanks for joining here. And hopefully we'll see you soon.
Thanks a lot. Bye.
Take care, then.
Thanks, bye, everyone. Bye.